tweak the system balance, right? These two things kind of do similar things. HDAC and heat retarder. So let's just think. In the last homework, you did epigenetics. Is acetylation activating gene expression or suppressing gene expression? Acetylation always activates gene expression. So, but histone deacetylation is an enzyme that prevented the acetylation or removed the acetylation. And then when you have inhibitors like a magnesium negative, you actually active gene expression, right? In this case. It was first discovered, you know, like, so actually HDAC inhibitors have been approved with treatment a long time ago, before even people understand what exactly HDAC were doing very well. It was kind of tried. And interestingly, when they used the inhibitor, they saw that this can delay the development of drug resistance. This is related to a question I think Sam or Kate asked before. When you have these epigenetic inhibitors, wouldn't it have function across the whole genome? You know, why does it only work, you know, on the cancer cells? This is an open question. Most people don't understand. Indeed, these epigenetic inhibitors just work on cancer cells, potentially because the cancer cells are already epigenetically not so stable. And when you use the drug, you push it over the edge. Whereas when the, you know, like when you're down the hill going very smoothly, it doesn't really matter so much. You know, like when you have a little bump when you ski, you can just cross over, no problem. But when you're already kind of about to fall, then there's a little bump, you get stuck. Okay, so 5-azacitidine is a DNA demethylation enzyme. It's a drug that is inhibiting DNA methylation enzyme. It's like a DNMT inhibitor. So DNMT adds DNA methylation, and when you add the methylation, the very early thing that people notice is that when you have this same phenotype, DNA methylation are more focal in the promoter sequences of these genes, right? So the idea is, can we use a demethylation to remove the hypermethylation and somehow get the genes to express again? Because a lot of those genes are related to tumor suppressor loss. You know, they're totally silent. And so if we do demethylation of the promoters, can we activate gene expression in those cases? This drug was previously FDA approved. It was used for treating different things. Initially, it was a toxin, I think in the mustard gas. It's in the World War I biological weapon. It was really bad, very toxic. And then it was used to treat MDS, which is kind of pre-leukemia situation. So when the patient, you know, they come into the hospital with a fever, and not normally check their white blood cells, oh, you know, something is happening. But they are not quite leukemic yet. They are called MDS. And those patients, when you treat with 5-azacitidine, with very high dose, can kind of be used as a treatment. But later on, people, Peter Jones' group, which they are in the University of South Southern California before, and now in Vando Research Institute, they decided, you know, can we treat a And also, by the way, he has a very close collaboration with Stephen Bailey and Johns Hopkins. They were thinking, if we use this drug to treat the patient just transiently with like a third of the dose that you normally treat the MDS patient. And so they tried it, and it's like transient low dose of DNA demethylating agent with this 5-azacitidine. Not only they just treat with a third, like a very little dose, they also just treated a little bit. And then they want to see what happens. It exerts durable anti-tumor effect on the hematological as well as epithelial tumor cells. This is one example they have. In some of the early studies, this is the cancer cell. You treat the cancer cell with this 5-azacitidine, which kind of demethylates the DNA methylation in the cells a little bit. And then you put the cell into the mouse, and then sometimes you add even a second Scandinavian or Asiatic, they grow much, much slower in the tumor. So a couple of things might be happening. You can imagine when you treat the cell with an HDAC inhibitor. So potentially, when previously, the tumor has a very wide kind of plasticity, you can, you know, because tumor all have heterogeneity. Potentially, when you treat with HDAC inhibitor or 5-azacitabine, it kind of, because it's a little toxic, right, it can probably shrink the cell heterogeneity a little bit. And when you put it in the tumor, in the mouse, there are additional selection. And then they just don't grow as well. But recently, there are also studies. Yeah, so originally, they were just treating the cancer cells. And now, instead of treating the cancer cell, they just put the tumor into the mice and then directly treat the mice. And they see whether 5-azacitabine will make the tumor grow slower. And you can see as increasing dose, increasing days of the treatment cycle, saline is just control. The mice that are treated with the 5-azacitabine always grow a little bit slower. And so, so what is the really the effect of this? You know, first of all, they see minimum dosage and toxicities, they're much better tolerated than the original, the master DAS and also the MDS drug. And sometimes they can just treat it transiently. Interestingly, it activates the suppressed immune genes. They look at the genes, a lot of those genes that are hypomethylated. It turns out it's related also to the immune system. And when they treat this, these immune genes get activated. In addition, the DNA methylation status at these immune genes can be used to predict the patient response. If those immune genes get suppressed, those are hypermethylated. And now with this demethylation agent, these genes will turn on, and then the cancer cell can actually respond to the immune attack a little better. Better in terms of killing the cancer cells. In addition, a small percentage of patients can directly be cured. And others are resensitized for chemotherapy. So previously, these patients, you know, when they are going on this trial, they didn't respond to whatever was the standard treatment. And now, even after the treatment, you know, like, I remember when this initial trial was published, it was like a miracle. A group of patients, lung cancer already, liver metastasized, you just treat them with this minimum dose of 5-azacitabine. Some of the patients get completely cured. It's truly amazing. And then other patients become more sensitive to previously resistant drugs, like chemotherapy. And also, recently, for this one, people are trying this with 5-azacitabine together with immunotherapy. Because when you treat a cell with 5-azacitabine, not only it activates the immune-related genes in the cancer cell, it also, the hypomethylated, you know, remember, those really silent regions now get activated. These cancer cells now have a macrocytolite instability in some sense. You know, all of their viruses, the repeat sequences now are getting expressed on the cell surface. And that will induce also a stronger immune effect. And then if you add immunotherapy, that actually is pretty effective in treating, treating patients. And so right now there are efforts combining these two drugs. So DNA methylation targeted DNA MT1 is targeting DNA methylation, but epigenetic regulator mutations in cancer are not just DNA methylation. Remember, we spent a number of lectures talking about histone modifications or nucleosome positioning. There are actually a lot of enzyme that regulates this, you know, how to position the nucleosome and also how to read, write, and erase histone marks on the histones, right? And so because they are so mutated, about, I would say 10 years ago, when people are just starting to sequence tumor genomes, they realized this. And then all the pharmaceutical companies, there has been a race to develop epigenetic inhibitors against those mutated epigenetic factors, especially if it's a gain-of-function mutation. So this is one trial that's actually, this trial probably will pass FDA fairly quickly. The company is in Boston.
as an epigenetic company.
So this is a disease called MLL leukemia. Kids with MLL leukemia used to be like death sentence, no cure whatsoever. So what happens is MLL in a number of leukemia, so in the MLL leukemia, you can see things translocated to the MLL. All of these ENL, AF9, and AF10, they are all kind of same family of proteins. So MLL is the front, and then the AF9 and AF10 are fused to it. And so MLL is actually the epigenetic factor. And it usually goes to the promoter of the gene. It goes to the H3K4 trimethylated gene promoters. And then we'll start initiating gene expression. So you can see here. But when the MLL and AF9 and AF10, or either one of these, are fused with the MLL, it will go to the promoter. And interestingly, very often you will see very super, super strong H3K79 methylation in the beginning of the gene. So as polymerase is elongating, it leaves a much stronger tail, a mark on the first exon, first intron. And the enzyme that writes this H3K79 trimethylation is called the DALT1L. So although the MLL leukemia mutation is on the MLL gene, the drug is actually on the DALT1L, which is the writer of this H3K79 trimethylation. It's on the on making this writing not so efficient. So apparently when the promoter or the first exon, first intron has H3K79 trimethylation, a lot of these genes will be super highly expressed because it seems like the barrier to move gene expression forward is much, much lower. They can just go. And so now the inhibitor is on DALT1L inhibitor to treat this MLL leukemia. And when you do this, it's pretty magical, like all the cancer cells get killed. And the funny thing here again is, if you look at the cells, most of the highly expressed genes have H3K79 trimethylation in the first exon and first intron. And when you use the inhibitor, you don't have the H3K79 trimethylation anymore. And yet, only the cancer cells are dying. Normal cells, no problem. We have even a collaborator who generated a mouse knockout. This gene is gone in normal mice. Nothing. No effect. And so really, I think it's like, in some sense, cancer cell is like a Soviet Union. You know, it's putting all its resources, everything depending on the production of some heavy, military weapon and sending a satellite. And then if other things come in, they just totally collapse. And whereas the normal economy is growing fine, you want to build more missiles, no problem. And so apparently the normal cells, when you have, whether this H3K79 trimethylation is there or not, no big deal. So yeah, that's the DALT1L inhibitor that's used for treating MLL leukemia. I think it's going to be FDA approved fairly soon. Another drug is an EZH2 inhibitor. Major pharmaceutical companies all have EZH2 inhibitor. So I think the company that made the DALT1L inhibitor also have an EZH2 inhibitor as well. So EZH2 inhibitor. So first of all, EZH2 is the gene that writes H3K27 trimethylation onto the promoters of genes, or sometimes gene binding of genes. It's kind of it forms a complex. And when the gene has H3K27 trimethylation, the gene is suppressed. The expression is very, very low. But then when EZH2 is overexpressed, you can see the promoter will have like K27 methylation. The transcription of these genes are going to be knocked out, or it will be turned off. People also see this UTX mutation. So this one is a writer, and this one is an eraser. Okay? So either of this, EZH2 overexpression or UTX mutation, is known to be related to a lot of cancers. chip seq analysis for estrogen receptor in breast cancer. Prostate cancer is, I think actually men when they are old, almost 90% of them has early breast prostate cancer. You know, you have some men who died at 90 years old, you look at their prostate, oh, they have prostate cancer. They may not even know it. It's like definitely happening. So most of these prostate cancers have an activated androgen receptor, and this androgen receptor is a transcription factor. It's similar to ER hormone, you know, like, so the androgen hormone go to the prostate cell, activates the androgen receptor, and androgen receptor as a transcription factor can activate a lot of genes. And so when you treat the cell with an AR antagonist, so, you know, like, when people have prostate cancer, you can do surgery, remove the tumor, but if it's already metastasized to the rest of the body, you have to treat the patient with a drug. Good thing is there is a pretty easy drug to treat. You just treat the cell with something that looks like an androgen hormone, but blocks the androgen receptor. And that has very, very low side effect. It's like a ER, same thing. But the patient in a few years will become hormone independent as well. And so we can do CRISPR screens in the prostate cancer cells with or without the hormone. You ask when you do not, you know, basically, when you treat the cell, when the cell doesn't have hormone, these are prostate cancer cells. They are like prostate cancer being treated with that drug that prevents the AR from getting activated. And so you can do this. So for example, you can see here, this is EVH2. When you use hormone, so by the way, so this is the order of the genes, and then this is the kind of the p-value. So these are the most significant, second significant, and so on. And so when we have a prostate cancer cell which has hormone, the cell is growing very well, EVH2 is not so important. These are not so significant. But if you don't have hormone, EVH2 is super significant. Very, very important. And so, which means that when the prostate cancer cell potentially develops resistance to this drug, EZH2 inhibitor could be very important to treat these hormone-independent prostate cancers. Okay? And so you can also see, we also talked about BRD4 in the next drug. That's also an important drug that Dana-Farber has. And so you can see here, so question is, what exactly is EZH2 doing in the cells? With epigenetic inhibitors, it's kind of interesting. Most of these regulators was discovered when people sequenced the human genome. Previously, we didn't know these genes. Like, oh, you sequence the genome, you see a domain, oh, this domain we know. This domain reads a histomark, or writes a histomark, or erases a histomark. And then you say, okay, that's an epigenetic regulator. And then you see these genes mutated in cancer, and pharmaceutical companies are developing drugs against these mutations, and yet they still don't know what that gene does. And then they now try to see, okay, we have a drug, we see the phenotype, what is this drug really doing? And so we are, this is one of the studies we're doing for prostate. Yeah, so potential target in hormone-independent prostate cancer is this EZH2 inhibitor and also BRD4 inhibitor. By the way, some of the other ones may or may not have a drug that you can use to treat. So the key is what genes are super important in prostate cancers when you don't have hormone. And those genes also have a drug. So EZH2, as we mentioned, is a member of the polycomb repressive complex. It writes the HDK27 prime isolation onto the gene to silence gene expression. Hopefully from homework 2, homework 5, you have seen that, right? All the PCA plot, all the K27 and K9 trimethylation are suppressing gene expression. They cluster together. So previously people see that EZH2 mutation leads to leukemia and lymphoma, and they are overexpressed. But in prostate cancer, we almost never see EZH2 to be mutated. We just see it being overexpressed. In hormone-independent prostate cancer. From the CRISPR screen, we also know it's very, very important. When you get rid of the gene, the cell will not be happy, it will die. So the question is, what is this doing? This is, let's see. Okay, so this is the prostate cancer cell. AD means the cell, so it's a kind of a cell line you can grow on the petri dish. We know that these type of cells, when you release the hormone. But then if you don't give it hormone, initially it will just be growing very slowly, but after, say, 9 months, we can get a cell line that is resistant. And they are called androgen independent, okay? So when we treat the cell with either an inhibitor or knock out the gene, you can see when in the initial cancer cells, when you knock out the gene or treat the cell with inhibitor, most of the genes are downregulated. You do see a small group of genes upregulated, but most of the changes are so this is, I think, a knockdown experiment. When you knock down the gene, they are, I think this is going in the opposite direction. These genes are high in the androgen-dependent one, but they are low in the androgen-independent cells. Whereas the androgen-independent cells, you can see a lot of these genes are actually activated. And so we are asking what happened. You know, like when you have this EZH2 that's overexpressed, shouldn't it suppress more genes? But turns out they are actually activating more genes, which is really weird. And because when you have a gene that's overexpressed and it's writing a lot of H3K27 trimethylation, it should suppress genes. But when we see this, we're like, oh, seems like it's activating genes. And if you look at those genes that are activated, you know, we run some gene set enrichment in the gene set, you can see a lot of these other signatures that are activated in the EZH2 activated genes are related to recurrence at 5 years, high-grade tumor, dead in 3 years, advanced disease, metastatic, and things like that. So these are really genes that are bad for the cancer cell, right? And so we're asking what happens with this. And so we can do a ChIP-seq of both the EZH2 and also the H3K27 trimethylation. And so when we do the histomark or and the EZH2, you can see, remember, this is the enzyme that writes the K27. We can see across the genome there are many, many different of these binding sites. And most of these also have varying level of H3K27 trimethylation signals in here, meaning that this is the early prostate cancer, where EZH2 and the H3K27 trimethylation still co-occur together. So your enzyme goes there, it will spread the mark nearby, okay? But then in later on, in the hormone-independent cancer type, this is a cell line that's kind of derived from the original one, you still see most of the regions when the EZH2 is binding, H3K27 trimethylation is spreading. But then there is a whole group of genes that have just EZH2 binding, but no repressive histone marks here. And so actually, if we look at these genes, a lot of these genes are the genes that are highly expressed in the hormone-independent prostate cancers. They are now being activated. We also see these EZH2 binding sites are associated with gene activation and active histone marks. And so the question is, what is it doing? And we look at the motif near those peaks, and it turns out androgen receptor is binding in this location. And so, you can see here in these ensemble. So ensemble means these top peaks that have EZH2 and also the suppressive marks. You don't really see androgen receptor co-binding, but in these these regions that just have EZH2 but no suppressive functions, we see actually strong AR binding. It turns out actually in prostate cancer, we have the model here. Yeah, so there are other biochemistry and genomic work involved. So we found kind of interesting. In prostate cancer, originally EZH2 is a suppressor. It goes to the promoter of genes, it expresses H3K27 trimethylation to silence the genes. But in the hormone-independent prostate cancer, EZH2 is often upregulated, and also a particular phosphorylation on these genes becoming very important. Once it's phosphorylated, it no longer is in this complex. So in the prostate cancer, we still, later stage, we still see some of this, but when EZH2 is activated with phosphorylated, sometimes it will go off its complex and then partner with androgen receptor. And that will activate a lot of cell cycle genes, which are bad. So you can see the gene regulation for these drugs very different. You know, the same drug can be inhibiting the enzyme, but actually in different cancers doing a totally different job. And so these are all still being actively worked on. So potentially we can target both AR and EZH2 in the hormone-independent prostate cancer. And the third one is JQ1. So this is a gene that we mentioned briefly in the epigenetic lecture. So JQ1 is a bromodomain domain inhibitor. It reads acetylation. So read acetylation is like this. You know, in the promoters, very often you see these acetylation marks in here, and the bromo domain is here, PRD3 and 4, and sometimes PRD2 as well. They go to the promoter and they also try to recruit other activation things in here. And so JQI is a drug that inhibits this reading effect, and so a lot of the genes no longer can be activated. So at Dana-Farber, Jay Brenner's lab developed this inhibitor. It inhibits this, and they tried it a number of cancers, leukemia, they tried it on midline carcinoma. Midline is like here, some cancer that is just growing this way, and actually it works very well. And so interestingly, this BRD4 recruits the elongation complex, so transcription can actually happen. And interestingly, most of the genes, if you look at the BRD3 or 4 binding or the JQ1, where they go to in the genome, most of it goes to the promoters of super enhancer target genes. You guys remember super enhancer? So that region near the promoter or near the enhancer have very, very high and long and high regions of HPK27 acetylation. So these genes are super high. And so when you treat the cell with this drug, it actually goes to these super enhancer target genes and really stop the cancer growth.